About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Dog Training Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. And this evening, we're going to be talking about the Berks County Dog Training Club's annual obedience trial. So our guests this evening are Lynn Millar, who is the show chairman, and she is on my right. She has a Sheltie. And on my left is Nancy Withers, who is co-chair and also on the show committee, and she has a Sheltie. Well, she also has a Corgi, but she has a Sheltie. And to Lynn's right is Kathy Maydosz, and she's on the show committee as well, and she has a Sheltie. So it's like, okay, thank goodness Nancy brought her nice little Corgi, so we have some kind of difference. Anyhow, so Lynn, suppose you tell us what a trial is. It's an obedience trial. What does that mean?
Also known as an obedience show.
Okay.
It's when we bring a judge and you enter your dog and you come in and you go through some of the exercises in the class level that you've entered.
Okay.
And you're sort of tested. It's like a little quiz to see how you're doing with your training.
Okay. Okay.
That's how I like to look at it.
Okay. And then you're marked off for any mistakes you make.
You're definitely marked off. You definitely get a grade for sure.
And you get a grade.
You get a grade.
So where is this show going to be?
This is at the 4-H building, which is on County Road, right behind the Ag Center.
Okay. All right. Yeah, we all know where that is. It's right near where the Pet Expo was, sort of like in front of where the Pet Expo was this past weekend, which we went to and did a little obedience demonstration. And we all know that it's the Reading Fairgrounds, so it's in front of the Reading Fairgrounds. Just go down the road a little bit further. And what time does it start?
We're beginning at 8:30, I believe, Nancy.
Whoa,
is that correct?
That's early.
Yeah, well, that's actually not early for us. That's, but 8:30 we get started. Otherwise, we'd be there till dark.
Yeah.
You know, so we do want to get home to our families.
Right. Well, this is inside, right?
It is indoors,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, because we don't have to worry about the weather.
That's
once
right.
You're indoors. That makes it much easier.
It does help.
So then it goes how long? If I got there, say, after church on Sunday, because it is, give us the date. What is it?
May 18th.
And that is a Sunday. I know it's on a Sunday.
It's a Sunday. Uh-huh. And by 2 o'clock, many of the rings will be finishing up and we'll be switching over to rally.
Okay.
But there would still be things going on.
Okay.
Pretty much all day. There'll be something going on. We hope to finish before 4.
Okay. Okay.
So maybe we'll even finish a little before that.
Okay. So then if I came after church, Nancy, I'd still be able to see something?
Yes.
Okay.
The obedience, like Lynn said, we plan to have it wrapped up around 2 o'clock.
Okay.
The rally will run till about 4:30, I would guess, with what we have entered.
Okay. Okay.
That would be my guesstimate. So.
Okay. So what kind of classes? You're saying obedience and rally. What's the difference?
Okay. Obedience is a more structured type of performance where the dogs are judged how accurately and promptly they respond to the owner's commands.
Okay.
Rally is not as rigid. There's more verbal communication between the dogs and handlers. They may clap their hands, pat their sides, talk to the dogs continually, whereas in a regular straightforward obedience you cannot. Rally is a relatively new sport. It's about 9 years old. And it's grown in popularity. It's sliding back just a little now, but it's a good introduction for lots of people to the more formal obedience.
Okay, okay. You want to tell us what kind of classes, Lynn said, the classes you entered. What classes are we talking about?
All right, this is strictly a pre-entered type of event.
Okay,
the entries have closed. They closed last Wednesday. We have 123 dogs entered in obedience and 43 in rally.
Oh, wow.
There is the full gamut of classes from what is known as beginner novice. That's basically all done on leash, not real strict with the scoring, and it's for beginner dogs and maybe beginner handlers and more experienced handlers, all the way up to utility. And that is the most advanced of the obedience classes. which things are done by signals, no verbal communication, scent work is done, directed jumping as they are directed by the handlers. The rule book, which this is a copy of the American Kennel Club Obedience Regulations, describe all of the exercises and how they are to be judged. This allows for more uniform judging of the exercises, whether you be showing or judging in California or in Pennsylvania.
Okay, so it's the same rules.
Uniformity is, and consistency is the key, and that's why we have at our access
a rule book.
A rule book.
Yes. Just like any other sport, there's a rule. Lynn, what other classes can you enter besides beginner, novice, and utility? There's got to be something in between there.
Yes, well, novice is the is a starting point where it's mostly just healing.
Okay.
And a little bit of, and the stays at the end, group stays.
Okay.
And
okay.
Then there's a recall off leash. So
okay.
Like a 30-foot, you leave your dog and 30 and walk 30 feet away and call your dog to come when the judge tells you to.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And then there's a group stays, it's called, but you stay in the ring. So maybe 6 or 8 dogs will come in together and lay about 4 feet apart or sit about 4 feet apart. You'll leave your dog, walk to the other side of the ring, but you stay in the ring with your dog on the novice level.
Okay, and then there's no talking. If your dog gets
talking.
And walks towards you, then they blew it.
They get a zero.
Okay.
That's
pretty much blown.
That day.
Yeah. Zero.
Try again
failing.
Next time.
Yeah.
Or if they lie down and they're supposed to stay sitting,
that's also
zero. Or stand up and they're supposed to be lying down.
Yep.
That's an NQ. They might have stayed where they were left, but they have to stay in the position where they were left.
That's the owner left them.
We've all been there.
Yes,
especially
with
Shelties.
Yes,
happens to the best of us.
Shelties that have broken a sit stay, there are those that have and those that will.
Okay, all right. Now, a judge is what, following you, standing in the middle of the ring, telling you what to do? How do you know what to do?
Well, you know the exercises that are involved in the class manner. You've been practicing them.
Okay.
In fact, we our club has practice matches, so we go and practice showing every month, so we're familiar, we're comfortable, we're not too nervous, but we're still a little
Everything's
nervous.
Everything's relative, right?
and then you walk in, and the judge says, we're going to start here, this will be the heel and leash, they'll tell you that, and then they'll tell you forward when you're ready to start, and they tell you when to halt.
Mm-hmm.
They'll say, exercise finished, then they'll say, okay, next we're going to do the recall, we'll start over here.
Okay.
So they move you over to that part of the ring. So they move you around the ring and tell you. And plus, you watch the people before you.
Okay.
So that's always helpful, too, so you have an idea of what's going to happen
next. So you hate being number one, huh?
Yeah, it's a little harder.
But I want to interject. A judge is obligated to tell the first exhibitor, maybe about 5-10 minutes before they come in the ring, what exactly the healing pattern is going to be, where they're going to do the stand for examination, where they're going to be do the recall. So you're not going in totally cold.
Okay.
This is definitely a requirement of the judge that they tell you all of this.
Then the judge has what, a score sheet that he marks? And
they have a worksheet.
Okay.
And it's points off.
Okay.
A perfect score is 200 for the obedience, any obedience class.
Okay, for all of the classes.
And
okay.
to qualify, you must have a minimum of 170 points and more than half of the points in each available exercise.
Okay, so like our Shelty that laid down on the sit stay, that even if the dog might have had 170 points, that zero means they don't get anything.
It could have had a perfect 140 points in the first part of the individual exercises, but if it went down on the group stay, it's
zero.
It's NQ, nothing. Non-qualified for that day.
Oh, that's a shame.
Well, it happens.
Yeah, I guess so. I'm sure the dog's not very upset, but I'm positive the handlers are. But
some dogs know when they've done, when you walk back to them and you give them the evil
eye. Well, yeah, they probably know when you're across the ring that they're getting the evil eye. So besides the novice, we have beginner, novice, and we have novice. Now, what else?
The next level would be open.
Okay. Okay.
And in open, we're going to add retrieve with, I have a dumbbell right here.
Okay.
The dog will wait, you'll throw this, and then when the dog judge tells you to, you send your dog to get it. They can bring it directly back to you within reach.
Uh-huh.
And hold it there, and you take it back from the one the judge tells you to.
Okay. Well, what happens if the dog spits it out?
Nancy, what happens with the dog
spits it out? Okay. If the dog drops it out at your feet, that you can reach the dumbbell without moving your feet, it's points off, 3 to 5 points off. If it's gone out to retrieve and it picks it up and it fumbles a little and drops it and picks it up, that's a couple of points off. Everything, a judge has a picture of perfection in their mind, what is expected. The rule books spell out what is expected, but something like that, as long as you can reach it without moving your feet, it's going to be points off. Don't just tell the dog to take it. Let the judge make that decision.
Okay.
People do this all the time. They say, oh, take it. Well, then that gives the judge no choice but to non-qualify that particular exercise.
Okay, so if you're given another command to the dog.
Yes,
okay.
Uh-huh.
So then you're only allowed to tell the dog to do the exercise once.
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay.
We didn't make that clear.
No, we didn't.
That's important.
Yeah. So you can't keep telling the dog to do it and do it and do it and do it. It's once and done.
Except in beginner novice, they're allowed to give a few extra commands, but that is a very beginning. But the other classes, once and done.
So it gets harder and harder and harder the higher up you go, huh?
So the other exercises in open include, after you've done the, we call it retrieve on the flat, and you've thrown the dumbbell on with no jump, then you throw it over a jump, and the dog must go over the jump, pick up the dumbbell, come back over the jump with the dumbbell in their mouth.
Okay.
Again, bring it to you. Uh-huh. Same thing. Another exercise in that class is the drop on recall. That it's just like the recall in novice, where the dog has to come 30 feet, but partway through the judge signals you to drop your dog, and the dog has to lay down halfway to you and wait for you to call. The judge will tell you again, to signal you again to call the dog in, and the dog comes in
a recall is a come when called.
Recall is direct come when called.
Okay, okay.
And on this, the dog has to stop halfway and lay down.
Okay.
With one command.
Okay.
And then when you call him, come into you.
Okay.
And then the last exercise in that is called the broad jump. It's just a very low flat jump.
Okay.
The dog has to go over and come back
now,
to you.
How do you know, you say a jump, is this the same size jump for every dog?
They're uniform. Well, the jump itself is uniform.
Okay.
But the height changes according to the shoulder height of the dog.
Okay, so then they have to jump their shoulder height. So if my dog's 24 inches at the shoulder, he has to jump 24 inches?
There's an actual chart that'll tell you exactly. There's a range depending. Okay. Now my 16 and a half inch dog jumps 16 inches.
Okay.
Or 16 and a quarter she is, or something like that.
Okay.
She jumps 16.
Okay, so you don't have a 17 inch jump, so then the dog would have to jump 18 or jump 16?
Well,
they're in increments of 2 inches.
Uh-huh.
17 inches and under would jump 16. There also are maybe 40 breeds or such that are larger boned breeds that only jump 3/4 their height.
Okay.
Newfoundlands.
English Bulldogs are what I always think of.
Bernese Mountain Dogs.
Yes. Okay. The deep,
Mastiffs.
Yeah.
Yes.
The
larger boned.
Dogs. Okay.
I believe Cardigan Welsh Corgis.
Basset Hounds. Okay.
But the larger breed dogs, boned dogs, jump a lower 3/4 of their height. You'll have a Newfoundland come up and say 18 inches, and you think, oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
They jump 3/4.
So what about the little dogs, like a Chihuahua? How far down does it go? 2 inches?
4 inches.
4 inches?
Is the minimum height.
Okay, okay. So then Chihuahuas are good jumpers anyway. Well, we have to take a break right now. Then we're going to show you a little demonstration. We have our dogs here that are going to do a demonstration for you, okay? So come back.
Can I wake him up?
You're watching All About Dogs on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other stories about animals and pets, go to www.bctv.org. All About Dogs is underwritten by the Berks County Kennel Club and by Berks Dog Training Club. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
We need to move our dogs. You're going to try and...
Yeah, we're gonna do a demonstration right here. And since we're talking about the open class, she's going to do a retrieve with her Sheltie. Now, Shelties all have about the same size dumbbell. Each person has their own dumbbell, right?
Yes.
Okay. Because I didn't know if I wanted somebody, another dog spit on my dumbbell. But yeah, I'm sure the dog doesn't care. Okay, what she's going to do is make the dog stay still. He's going to stay. She's going to throw the dumbbell. Then she's going to send the dog for the dumbbell. He's going to pick it up, bring it back to her, and hold it until she asks for it. Okay, are you ready?
Ready.
Okay, throw it. Whoops, she threw the dumbbell. Okay, send him.
Fetch. Front.
He brings it right in. He's sitting and holding it, and take it. And finish.
Swim.
Very good. Now, the dog has to, little treat, which we can also use in the ring, but this is practice, so the dog has to go back into heel position when you say swing, the dog had to go back into heel position. Okay. So you're ready to start out again. Do you want to do that again so we can get it a little bit better? Maybe you can focus on the dumbbell to show.
Yeah.
There, that's better.
Fetch. That's a boy.
And he sits again, holds it, take it, and finish.
Swing.
That was much better. We could see that lots better. We didn't see your back.
So a pickup.
Right. You could see how the dog readily went out and picked it up and brought it right back. Do you want to show us a little bit of healing?
Sure. Three.
This you're going to see a fair amount of, because in every single class, from beginner novice all the way up to utility, they do healing, which of course is the dog at your left knee. Okay, forward.
Heel.
And halt. The dog should sit as soon as she stops walking. Forward.
Heel.
About turn.
Here.
Dog will stay right with her. About turn.
Here.
It's a little, and halt. Again, the dog sits forward.
Heel.
About turn. And halt. Exercise finished. Great. Very good. Thank you.
He is used to much faster.
Yes. Yeah. Let's face it. This is not where we would normally be working. We work in a large area. They're in a ring. What size are the rings?
A ring is generally 40 by 50 feet long.
Okay.
Minimum of 30 by 40 feet is the minimum size.
Yeah. If you're talking 40 by 50, what do we have here? Maybe 10, if that?
10 by 10.
Yeah, 10, yeah, maybe 10 by 10. So the dog is not used to working in this environment. We have matting, but it's not carpeting. We certainly don't have spots on them. So it's all totally different for the dog. So yeah, they're used to working lots faster, because most of us walk lots faster than that, but she would have walked right through the wall.
Right. I go very, very fast with my dog.
Yes, you're
a
great dog. And we have the sits and downs. So suppose you explain the sits and downs in the open.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Kathy.
Go right ahead.
Kathy. You're doing it.
Are you showing in the open class?
No, not yet.
Okay.
Not yet.
Okay.
Actually, we're both in pre
pre, okay.
Until we get going.
Okay.
He is trained through open, though, and utility. But the open sits and downs are difficult because you do have a group sit and a group down. You'll bring your dogs into the ring, and the judge will tell you to sit your dogs, and everybody sits their dogs. And they will tell you to leave your dogs, and you leave your dogs, and you go outside the ring completely. So it's out of sight sits and downs.
Oh, okay.
So you're outside of the ring for 3 minutes for the sit. Then the judge will tell you to come back in the ring, and you have to come back in the order that you went out.
Uh-huh.
You stand in front of your dogs, and you're probably about 30 feet away from your dogs.
Mm-hmm.
And then the judge will tell you to return to your dogs, and you return to your dogs, and you return into heel position.
Okay.
The same thing for the downs. The judge will give you the commands to down your dogs, and everybody does it at once. Leave your dogs, and you go out of the ring for 5 minutes. And then you go back into the ring when the judge tells you to come back into the ring. And then the judge will tell you to return, and you return to your dog in heel position. Your dogs have to sit, and they do have to stay for that entire time that they are in there. No. Very difficult for the dogs.
Yeah, yeah, it is, because their owners are leaving them all by themselves, and you have, what, 8 or 10 dogs in the ring? It's pretty impressive, yeah. Because every single dog is laying side by side by side with enough space for their human in between, but all the dogs are just laying there, and there's nobody around in the ring except for the judge and the two helper dogs. They're called stewards. The two helpers are there just in case, but there's no handlers in the ring. They've left. And the dog has, of course, if the dog sits up, remember, any dog that doesn't stay in position is disqualified. So you may actually qualify all the way up to that point, and the dog may sit up when you're coming back to the dog, and the dog didn't stay for the 3 minutes. So, you know, that the last half a minute, your dog blew the entire thing. But none of these dogs would ever do that. I mean, look at how good they're being, right?
Well, I was showing Scout in Open this past fall, and it happened that somebody was also showing a young Newfoundland hound that was the size of a horse.
Oh, my word.
And because he didn't have to jump as high, he was slotted next to me every single
18 inches.
Show.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my word.
And she was he was a sweet dog, but he was just like busy sniffing and looking around, and she was like really not happy to have to sit next to him.
But well, he was, what, 4 times her size?
Oh, every bit of it. It was like sitting next to a horse.
So that's another thing that we can bring up. So then what, the dogs are judged in the order that they're the height jump? So
not
that
always. Okay. Some shows set that up. Now, we set it up that way because it's easier. The judge
and stewards
don't have to change the jump heights as often.
Every time, okay.
But some shows don't do that.
Okay.
Some shows just take it however the entries come in, they show them in that order. Mm-hmm. And you never know where you're going to be. But most of the obedience clubs put them in order of jump height because it's more thoughtful to this.
Yeah.
For the ring crew.
Well, yeah, you know, so all the 18-inch dogs are jumping, like you said, a Newfoundland jumping 18 inches and her jumping 18 inches. So you'll see big dogs and little dogs that are jumping the same height, and that's because they are so large. Now, any dog can enter this show? Or just purebreds?
It used to be AKC registered purebreds.
Okay.
But our club voted to, AKC allows mixed breeds, or they call it All-American breed, I think they call them.
PAL. It's a PAL number.
Right.
They do have to be registered, though, with the AKC.
Okay.
There is a registration. It's not a purebred dog registration.
Uh-huh.
It just shows that they're neutered.
Okay.
And then they can be registered. They pay a price.
Then they get a registration number.
Yeah.
So how do you actually enter this show? Since you said entries closed.
We enter, entries for shows usually close about 2.5 weeks before the show, so that it gives time for the secretary to compile a list of all of those entered and make up a catalog and books for the judges and such. There's a lot of paperwork involved in this because every dog that's judged that day, a report has to be sent to the AKC.
Okay. So then this is it's kept in a book? If I go to see the show, I can get one of these books?
You can get a catalog.
Okay.
And you can see a copy of the judge's book where they actually write the scores. It will be posted at the end of each class.
Okay. So
you
can
see where you lost your points or where Kathy's dog lost her points or whatever, such as that.
Okay. Well, that's important for the exhibitor.
Right? One point I'm not sure we made is that our goal for this show is to go and qualify 3 times in a class.
Okay.
In order to get a title.
Okay.
So
she
has in 3 separate shows. So she did that 3 times in novice, so she has her CD, her companion dog title.
Okay, so you do get titles then.
And then she's done it 2 times in open, so one more time and she'll have her CDX, or companion dog excellent title.
And then
so
you go into the last class, which is the utility dog.
Then you'd have a utility dog.
Okay, so then
UD.
The initials go after the
dog's name. So after her registered name is the initials of the classes that she's qualified in.
One thing before we close this evening, if you are bringing children, please do not let them run up to the dogs. Like we said, you do get a little nervous as you're going in the ring because you want your child to do really, really well. You all know, your kids with your parents with baseball kids and football kids, you want your kid to do really good. That's how we feel about our dogs. So please don't run up to touch the dogs. Actually, do not touch the dogs unless you ask the handler or the owner if you can touch the dogs. And please leave your own dogs at home. The dogs that come into the building are entered in the show, and they need to be the dogs that are listed in the catalog. So only entered dogs are allowed to be in the building. So let your own dog at home. And we didn't really say a thing about Rally, except it's going to be there. It's fun. So come and see it. It's May the 18th at the 4-H Community Center.
Free of charge.
It's free. Parking is
and
free.
Good food available.
Yep, there's also food available. and it'll be from like 8:30 until 4:30 for this evening. Good night.
There's not a lot of things free.
Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.